Good morning, people of Zion. If you're watching this, you obviously are watching us online. And we want to welcome you and thank you for joining us. Today is a rather unique Sunday. Women of the Word are offering their thank offering worship service that we do every year at this time. Due to the sensitivity of the video that we are showing from our missionaries, we will not be streaming this particular worship service today. However, the service that is going to be streamed is from 2018. It is the Women of the Word thank offering at that time. Miss Judy Johnson, our music director, is preaching. So I want to thank you for joining us, and hopefully that this service is as inspirational and as meaningful as it was in 2018. Until next week, when we will be live again, streaming, I want to thank you for your patience and your spirit, and pray that you have a blessed week, and I so am happy and so thankful that you continue to join us on Sunday morning. God bless, and we'll see you next Sunday.
Let us sing.
Hear us, Lord, as we come to worship you. Hear us, Lord, may our praises honor you. Cleanse our hearts, free our minds, and let your Spirit flow. Hear us, Lord.
We ask that you hear us, Lord, this time as we gather together.
People of God, rain down upon us your presence and your power, your peace. Bless this time together in fellowship, and in hearing your word, strengthen our faith. Give us courage to meet the days ahead in the sure and certain hope that you have all things in your hands. Lord, bless this time of worship wherever it may be. We thank you for those congregations here in Kerrville who lift up the name of Jesus, who proclaim you as Lord and Savior. We thank you for congregations and Christians all over this world who come together, some secretly, that your name might be a light to a broken world. Bring peace upon our land. Bring peace to our hearts. And let our worship be pleasing unto you. We ask all these things through him who was and is and always will be, the one we call Jesus the Christ. And all of God's people say, Amen. Let us confess together our sin as we pray together the prayer of confession. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us take a moment to confess to God our own private and silent sins. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives power to become children of God and bestows on us his Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. With that that forgiveness. Let us sing together. Now thank we all our God.
The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God, what is it? And the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Ah, gee. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. The reign of God and for peace throughout the world. For the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. For your people here who have come to give you praise, for the strength to live your word, let us pray to the Lord.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord,
have mercy.
Help, save, and defend us, O God.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to God's people on earth.
The
be seated. Today's lesson is written in Luke chapter 17, beginning at the 11th verse. Now on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. And as he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go, show yourselves to the priest." And as they went, they were cleaned. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back, praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Rise and go. Your faith has made you well." The word of the Lord.
If I can get all the kids to come up. Be cautious. Easy, easy, easy. We're going to talk about some magic today. You guys like magic? Yes. A yes, a no, and a maybe. Magic words. What are the magic words? Close. Abracadabra, close. You've ever heard say, use the magic words.
Please.
Please. It's a great, see? We just did a magic trick. That was it. That was the magic trick. I taught you the magic words. If you want something, you ask for it, you always say, please. But there's the other part of that. If you receive something, what should you say?
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, two things happening today. It's Veterans Day. And we had our veterans stand up, and we gave them a round of applause because we were doing what? What were we doing? Recognizing them and thanking them for their further service. Second thing happening today, it's a thank offering, and we're focusing on thanking women for their service. We're thanking the Lord for all he has done for us. Maybe Thanksgiving is coming up. Thanksgiving break is coming up. I know you guys aren't looking forward to that time off.
No.
You want to rather just go straight through on school.
No.
I guess my question is, do we need a day in order to thank God for all he's done for us? Do we need to set aside one day to do that? Du says yes. Trace says no. Will says no. Can we do it every day? Yes. And should you do it every day? Yes. So when you're provided for, you should always say thank you. But really, you should spend time every single day thanking God for all he has done in your life, all he has provided for. In this day and age, sometimes we get caught up in what we don't have, and we forget to thank God for what we do have. Can we pray for that? Hands together. Dear Lord, thank you for providing for our needs each and every day. Thank you for providing people who are out there serving your will, both our veterans and every person in the daily life who's just looking to teach another soul about Jesus Christ. Thank you for providing and serving for us today. Thank the women who are involved in the service. Thank you for these children and all that they may do with their lives. And all the children say,
amen.
Let us bow our heads and pray. Dear gracious and most holy Father, we're thankful that we can come before you. Lord, we're thankful for those who served in our military. We're thankful that we can come to you in appreciation for all that they've done and to help those who are in need. We pray that you'd be with our speaker this morning as she brings us your word. Open our hearts to accept it with love and kindness, and that we might live closer to you. We ask this in the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
I have some notes here. Several years ago, and I do mean several years ago, we were still in the old church. Worshiping there was a couple, a young woman, and two children, sitting right down in front of the altar. That was their pew. My thoughts at the time were, why are they sitting down there in the front with those small children? Because I sat in the back with mine. And you will know as they were very good children. As time moves along, the children grow up and move on. But the couple and the young woman stayed and sat in their pew. As I said, time moves along, and this young woman became very involved in Zion. She became our choir director, sacred arts director, plays the organ and piano, and plays many more instruments. Did I mention she taught music to some of our children and grandchildren? With her in their pew were her children, Matt and Rebecca, and her parents, Pastor Neil and Evie. We give you Judy Johnson this morning.
Well, that was a surprise. Yes. Sometime last summer, Pastor Mike was preaching, and he had some points to his sermon. And he made a comment, well, I never have points to my sermon. Do you remember saying that? Yeah. Well, this particular pastor had points, and he had lots of points. And his congregation was not too thrilled at the length of his sermons and all the points he had. So he decided that he was going to mend his ways. So the very next Sunday, he got up and he said, well, I realize I've had a lot of points to my sermon, but I'm happy to report to you this morning that my sermon is pointless. Yeah. Okay, the thank offering service. And I chose this text about the 10 lepers that were healed by Jesus. Leprosy is a skin disorder, you know this, that eats away flesh. It's contagious. And way back in the book of Leviticus, we have God's directions about that. So I'm going to read from chapter 13. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron, when anyone has a swelling or a rash or a bright spot on his skin that may become an infectious skin disease, he must be brought to Aaron the priest or to one of his sons who is a priest. When the priest examines him, he shall pronounce him ceremonially unclean. The person with such an infectious disease must wear torn clothes, let his hair be unkempt, cover the lower part of his face, and cry out, unclean, unclean. As long as he has the infection, he remains unclean. He must live alone. He must live outside the camp. And these poor souls, some of them lived out all of their lives outside the camp, never able to return to their homes or to their families. No healing in this story happened until they got up and went on their way. Did you notice that? Another person in scripture that had leprosy was Naaman. Naaman was a valiant soldier, and he had leprosy, and he was very, very hopeful that the prophet Elisha would heal him. So he made all these arrangements to meet up with Elisha, and it was going to be a big whoop-de-doo, and that's not the way the story goes. Elisha sent a messenger to say to him, go wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you will be cleansed. Well, Poor Naaman, he went away angry. He said, where's all my whoop-de-doo and ceremony? I wanted Elisha to come out, and he's not coming. He's sending a messenger. He says, I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the spot, and cure me of my leprosy. And then he says, there's other rivers around here I could go wash in. Why do I have to go wash in the dirty old Jordan River? Couldn't I wash in them and be cleansed? Naaman says. So he turned and went off in a rage. Poor Naaman. But isn't that just like us? We hear things from the Lord, and they're so simple. Salvation is so simple, is it not? And we try to make it so difficult. Well, Jesus noted their ingratitude. Where are the other nine? He said. Notice that the one who returned was not only an outcast because he had leprosy, but what else was he? Do you remember in the scripture? What was he? He was a Samaritan. Samaritans were hated by the Jews. So he was a double outcast because of his disease and also because he was a Samaritan. Which proves that no one is excluded from God's mercy. No one for any reason. So the man who came back took time to acknowledge the giver. And not just the gift. The other nine, they were so busy, you know, enjoying the blessing, they forgot to go and thank the blesser. Think about when you get a gift. What happens when you get a gift? The person has to kind of know you, know what you want, know what you'd like. Those are the best gifts, aren't they? The ones that, people that know you really well. When I get a gift like that, I say, oh, you know me so well. Missy always gives me stuff about flip-flops. She gave me some flip-flop little things the other day, and I said, Misty, you know me so well. So they have to pick it out. They have to know you really well. Then they have to go and shop for the thing. Then they have to purchase the item. Then they have to wrap it somehow or other. And then they have to find a time to give it to you. So that's quite a long process. And you need to thank the person for that. Just like Shelby said, we teach our kids manners, you know. Evelyn, what do you say? Thank you. I haven't done this with Owen yet. Owen, he's 2.5. What do you say? Thank you. And with trunk or treat or with any kind of trick or treating, that is an excellent time for kids to say thank you. Thank you. I read in the newspaper, oh, this was a long time ago, back when we used to write thank you notes. Do you remember those things? It was a woman writing into Dear Abby, and she said she was bemoaning the fact that nobody writes thank you notes anymore, and kids are just not grateful anymore. So she said to Dear Abby, in my household, I tell my kids they can't play with it, eat it, wear it, read it, or watch it until they have written a thank you note. Dan Stisser, who is our praise team director, he bless his heart, he sends thank you notes. I mean, he could have just handed it to us while at rehearsal. He could put them in the boxes in the office if he wanted to. No, he writes a handwritten thank you. Thank you for what you did at the cowboy service, or thank you for the music at the picnic, or whatever. Puts it in an envelope, stamps it, and sends it in the mail. So we get those thank you notes at our houses. I'll have to thank him again for that, because that's kind of neat. Don't forget to thank the giver. Don't forget. It's so important. I love Psalm 103, don't you? Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. You know, as we get older, we tend to forget stuff, don't we? Well, there were these three ladies that were discussing that fact. And the first lady said, yeah, you know, standing in front of the refrigerator the other day with a jar of mayonnaise in my hand, and I couldn't remember if I was making a sandwich or I was trying to put it away. And the other one said, I know what you mean, Jesus. I was on the landing of my stairs, and I couldn't remember if I was going upstairs or coming downstairs. And the third lady said, oh, for heaven's sake. She said, it's a good thing I don't have that kind of trouble, knock on wood. Oh, there's the door. I'll get it. Oh. So when the one came back, he fell at Jesus' feet. Don't you love that slide? Mm-hmm. But you know what? We can't stay at Jesus' feet, can we? We've got stuff to do. We've got ministries to do. We've got people to serve. We've got things to do that are important. Jesus wants us to live out our thankfulness and tell everyone what he has done. You know that phrase? Tell everyone what he has done. Remember the liturgy we used to do in the green hymnal? That was called the post-communion canticle. So when we had Holy Communion, that was the little song that we sang afterwards. And some of you remember Pastor Steve when he was here. And so, Misty, I think you were in the choir then, and Jenny and some of you all that were in the choir a long time. We decided that when we got to the word shout in that post-communion canticle, we would do that. And the first Sunday we did that, he about jumped off his pew. We were in the old sanctuary. And so every time that little song came up and we were getting closer to that word shout, Mary, you remember that too. He would get this big grin on his face like, oh, here it comes, here it comes. Put that slide up. Okay, just for the fun of it. Some of you that remember this, let's sing it. I know you all don't, and I'm sorry to exclude you, but just for the fun of it, let's try it. Thank the Lord and sing his praise. Tell everyone what he has done. Let everyone who seeks the Lord rejoice and proudly bear his name. He recalls his promises and leads his people forth in joy with shouts of thanksgiving. Alleluia, alleluia. Wow, you do remember it. Awesome. Give yourself a hand. Yeah. When we thank him, we please him, don't we? Yeah. What is that thing that adage is more blessed to give than receive? Jesus wants us to call out to him. And we should return. We should return thanking him, praising and worshiping. A grateful heart is also a contented heart. Remember that story about the workers in the vineyard? Some of them were hired right at the beginning of the day, remember that? Some in the middle of the day, and then some came late. And they started working, you know, toward the end of the day. And they all got paid the same. And the ones that came late, I guess they were happy because they got full wages. And the ones that worked all day long, they weren't too happy about that. They started comparing themselves to somebody else, and that's not good. Here's another story about comparing. Two men went up to the temple to pray. One a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. This is from Luke chapter 18. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. God, I thank you that I'm not like other men. And then he lists all these sins. Do you remember that story? Yeah. He's actually bragging. He's bragging about what he has. I came across this little story about bragging. Let's see if I can pull this up for you. I have to read it because it's kind of long. A farmer from Texas, let's have that back again. A farmer from Texas was visiting a farmer in Georgia who was telling the Texan how big his Georgia farm was. Our property line starts here, the Georgian said, goes through those trees in the distance, along the stream on the left, cross those hills way over yonder, back along the road on the right, and back to his tree stump. Boy, he was bragging. Well, the Texan said, that's pretty big, but back home on our ranch, we get in the truck at sunrise, start to drive around the perimeter. I got to get my Texas accent going here. We drive and drive and drive. Then noon comes and drive some more and still don't get all around our ranch. We drive all afternoon. We stop for supper. Then we drive into the night and finally get home completely around our ranch. What do you think of that? And the Georgian says, yeah, I used to have a truck like that. So don't be bragging. You might get your cup comeuppance. Develop an attitude of gratitude. Praise transports us into God's presence. And also somewhere in Scripture, and I don't know where this is, Pastor Mike, it says God inhabits the praises of his people. Isn't that neat? So when we praise him, you know God is there. If you're truly thankful for what God has given you, which is way more than you deserve, right? You can't be discontent over what God hasn't yet provided. Think about Job. Oh, remember another message I said, he went from hero to zero in one day. And he had a lot to be upset about. And he could have shaken his fist at God, but he didn't. He said, the Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away. And then what did he say after that? Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all of that, he could still praise God. Gratitude shifts our focus from what's wrong to what's right. There was a little lady in our congregation up in North Dakota. When we saw her coming, we would just kind of, you know, maybe she didn't see me. But if you ever asked her how she was, she would give you this long litany of all these things and all her doctor's appointments and all of this and all of that. I felt bad for her because she couldn't be positive. She was so negative. There was a man in a nursing home. This is a story that my dad used to tell. I can still hear him telling it. This little man in the nursing home, he didn't have much. He was quite elderly, and he was always so positive. People would come and visit him, and he just never complained about anything, very positive. And this is what he would say. You know, he said, I've only got two teeth in my head, but they meet. That's a good one for you, Mike. I mean, look on the bright side. He's got two teeth and they meet. Oh, great. We've had so many natural disasters, and now we've got fires in California. Have you seen the news there, too? Oh, my brother lives south of Houston, close to the Gulf, and so he's got friends that still haven't been able to get in their homes after Harvey. Puerto Rico, I don't know, aren't there some places in Puerto Rico that still don't have electricity? I mean, that was just devastated. That has given me a real perspective on how good I have it. We just go to the wall, we turn on a light switch, right? We flush the toilet, we turn on the faucet, we have clean, drinkable water. We get on our smartphones, we're connected to the whole world. We have everything. Special offering this morning is, as you heard, is going to Food for the Poor. And this congregation has been so loving toward that cause. Pastor Mike, how many houses have we contributed to the down there?
I think with matching funds, 11 houses, and then on their way to 17.
Wow. He said 11 houses and getting on towards 17 houses. Yeah. Isn't this what God asks us to do? Jesus' ministry, so much of it was for the poor. Isn't that right? This text from Matthew 25. This is so familiar to you. And the ladies put that on their posters, I noticed. Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you? Or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? I tell you the truth. Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did it for me. Love that. God gives us everything. You know, some people say, oh no, God didn't give me that. I worked for that. I worked hard for that. That's my job. That's my promotion. You know, I've got a huge mortgage. I worked for that house. God didn't give me everything. Well, okay, who gave you your ability to work? Who gave you your eyes, your head, your heart, your hands, your freedom to work? You know, the fellow in the Bible who couldn't part with his money, the rich young ruler. Let's go to that story. Now I'm in Luke. A certain ruler asked Jesus, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And then they had this conversation, and Jesus said, well, you still lack one thing. Sell everything you have and give to the poor. and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me. When he heard this, he became very sad because he was a man of great wealth. Jesus looked at him and said, how hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. Seems like the last thing we're willing to relinquish is our money. Isn't that the truth? Sometimes I say you can know something about a person if you look in two things. Look in their checkbook and look at their music collection. So when it comes to tithes and offerings, some of us have a disease called cirrhosis of the giver. It's like, you know, you go to reach for your checkbook or your wallet and your hand just kind of goes, you know, just can't do it. So instead of griping about the 10% that we owe God, yes, I said owe, that's another whole sermon, isn't it? Be thankful for the 90% you get to keep. I don't know where I heard this, but Colgate, the magnate of the Colgate company, Mike, you're shaking, am I remembering this right? I think he gives 90% and lives on 10%, I think. I think I heard that one time. You know, true wealth is what money can't buy and death cannot steal. I've played for a lot of funerals. And what do they talk about funerals? About the man or about their portfolio? No. About how many houses they own? No. About this and that and cars and possessions? No. They talk about their legacy. How their children have been blessed by them. Their witness of their faith. Those are the things that death cannot destroy. God is generous. And he wants us to be generous. He wants us to be like him. God's watching how we use what we have. Remember that song by Bette Midler, From a Distance? From a Distance. Remember that? And she says, God is watching us. God is watching us from a distance? Yeah, sing it, Misty. God is watching us. I like that song. Proverbs 3:9 says, honor the Lord with your wealth. One time, Ronnie Pittman and I were talking. How many of you remember Ronnie and Mike Pittman? Okay. Anyway, we were talking about this show on TV called The Homes of the Rich and Famous. Do you remember that one? Yeah. Some guy with a British accent, I think, was the host of that. Who is it? Robin Leach. Okay. Anyway, I was saying to her, we used to read Oswald Chambers' devotions in the morning and get on the phone and talk about it. And I said, that is just so awful. You see that opulence. I mean, even the flusher on the toilet is made out of gold. It's just, why can't they do something better with that money? And Ronnie says, Judy, there are people on this planet that think our homes are like that. I thought, okay. True. Very true. If you invest all your time and energy and effort and talents in the things of this earth, I heard this the other day. So, here's the earth. If you invest everything here that you have, all your gifts, time, energy, money, everything, every day that you live, you're getting farther and farther and farther away from that, aren't you? If you invest your time and energy and talents in things of the Lord, treasures in heaven, every day that you live, you get closer, closer, closer to that. Kind of a neat picture. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. You know that song? Look full in his wonderful face, for the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. We sing that song, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Wonderful song. You know, God is asking us, what have you done with what I've given you? Just take a second. Think about that in your life. What have you done with what God has given you? And then he's going to ask you, and what have you done with my son, Jesus? It's important questions. Let's go back to Psalm 103, and here are some things that God has done for us. I'll start at the beginning again. Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Who forgives your sins? You're in the courtroom and you hear, not guilty. He heals your diseases. You're in a hospital room and the doctor says, you're well, you can go home. Who redeems your life from the pit? You're in jail and you hear the jailer say, you're released. He crowns you with love and compassion. You're in the throne room. You get the crown and you get the robe of righteousness. Who satisfies your desires with good things? You're in a banquet room. Remember Psalm 23? Prepares the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Remember that part? My cup runneth over. I'd like to close with a little table prayer that I learned as a child. And I guess my parents read it out of the King James Version because that's how I learned it. But it goes like this. The eyes of all wait upon thee, O Lord. Thou givest them their meat in due season. Thou openest thine hand and satisfiest the desire of every living Wow. Give thanks. Amen.
Please stand and let us sing together those very words. Give thanks. And now let us confess our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. And now let us pray for all people according to their needs. Gracious God, we have not given thanks with our hearts, our minds, and our voices. We have failed to recognize the great things that God has done through countless gifts of love. We have come today to remember and to give thanks. We thank you for your grace, for the many blessings we take for granted. Help us to see you every day in the changing seasons, in a baby's cry, in friends and strangers helping one another, in the tears shared in personal moments, in smiles shared with one another, in times that show your mercy, your grace, your provisions, and many other ways. Blessed be your name. Jesus, our Savior, we thank you for your sacrifice. While we can't understand why you left your throne, we know and we thank you that you came to save our souls. Holy Spirit, as we sang today, we pray that the sick say, I am whole. With this in mind, we seek your healing, your comfort, your care on Barbara Rahut, John Thompson, Rosalind Bell, Amy Jewell, Lamar Itz, James Cathy, Carlos Pfister, family of David Austin on his death, Jimmy Collier, Cohen LaCroix, Jason Spencer, Roy Dahman and Velda Donaldson, Lolita Holzer, Bob Silliman, Kendra Joins. We also remember, Lord, those in California who have experienced fires and ongoing smoke, for the increase of shootings and those blessed by food for the poor. The Spirit prompts us to be your hands and feet to those we have prayed for, as if you were standing right before us. Lord, we also lift up to you and ask for a special blessing on the prayer families of the week, Jody Jacoby, Kathy Tonner, and Sue Nelms. As we give you thanks today, remind us to continue our thanks every day, and let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated as we receive this morning's offering.
Thank you.
line as you'd like.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance, his favor, and give you his peace this week. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Let us sing together for the fruit of all creation. Congregational meeting. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.